this is a subject like you, this is a subject which is very close to my heart. And I've chosen this subject because the first book, I have written 14 books over the last few years, but the first book that I wrote in my life was having the same title, Economic Thoughts and Philosophy of Ambedkar. And I don't mind telling you the genesis of that book. You know, when I was explained, for 31 years I worked with the Reserve Bank of India. So main part of my professional life I spent in the Reserve Bank of India. I have not retired from anywhere. I have taken voluntary retirement. In other words, I have not crossed 60. That is what I am trying to say. So, but I have taken voluntary retirement from the Reserve Bank of India in 2008 when I was the chief economist of RBI. One thing which I was doing in Reserve Bank, among many things that I did, was I was a ghost writer. I was a speech writer for all the governors and deputy governors for nearly 20 years. From Manmohan Singh to Dr. Reddy, I have had the chance to work with them to write their speeches. The first round. There is a difference between writing the speeches of governor and writing speeches of minister, remember. Because governors are very, very competent people. So, you know, it was a learning experience for me to work with the governors and deputy governors. This book, Dr. Ambedkar's Economic Thoughts and Philosophy, started with a speech that I had written for Dr. C. Rangarajan, who at that time was the Deputy Governor of Reserve Bank of India. The year was 1989. And I had written some draft speech for him, and we were debating that speech. And during that speech, during the discussion, which was very educative for me, I must say that, there was an argument that I had made. And in the discussion, I mentioned to Dr. Rangarajan, this is the argument was made by Dr. Ambedkar. So he looked at me with surprise. He said, why would Dr. Ambedkar say this? I said, why not? You are the great economist. He started laughing. He said, Dr. Ambedkar, an economist. Well, Dr. Ambedkar was a great legal luminary. What did he know about economics? I was appalled because Dr. Ambedkar, friends, was the most educated economist in our country. And Dr. Rangarajan, as the deputy governor that time, and one of the finest economists in this country, I asked myself if the finest economist of our country does not even know that Dr. Ambedkar was an economist, there is something wrong there, and that has to be corrected. And I took upon myself the responsibility of going to people at large and explaining the kind of role that Dr. Ambedkar played as an economist. Do you know that Dr. Ambedkar was basically an economist? Although we know his, you know, the first thing that comes to average person's mind when we talk about Dr. Ambedkar is, of course, his work on the Constitution as the principal architect of India's Constitution. Of course that he was. But do you know that basically he was an economist by training? His MA degree in Columbia University was in the subject of economics. His PhD degree in Columbia University, taken in the year 1917, was in economics. Then when he went to England, he took Doctor of Science degree in 1923. That Doctor of Science degree was also in economics. But while doing his BSc, by the way, he is the only one who has the degree of Doctor of Science in economics in our country. While studying for the Doctor of Science degree, there was some administrative problem about the scholarship that he was getting, and that is why he had to also enroll in the law program, and that is what he did, and also became barrister while he was doing his Doctor of Science. So his law degree was on the side. You know, his main degrees were, and of all the degrees, he had four main degrees. I'm not talking about the honorary degree, but four main degrees. MA was in economics, PhD was from economics, both from Columbia University in the United States, and his Doctor of Science was in economics. Again, this was from the London School of Economics and Political Economy, London School of Political Economy, and the fourth degree was, of course, from law. So he was basically an economist. So if you want to analyze Dr. Ambedkar's economic thoughts and philosophy, you have to start with what he studied and what he produced. To look at Dr. Ambedkar's contribution to economics, one can divide this into two categories. One, his academic contribution to economics, and two, Dr. Ambedkar's practical contribution, what the Vice Chancellor was talking about, in terms of doing things in, you know, directly affecting people. These two are very different things. So let's start with the first part, where we talk about first about his academic contribution of Dr. Ambedkar to the field of economics, and then we'll talk about his actual practical policies which were influenced by Dr. Ambedkar's thinking as an economist. Remember that Dr. Ambedkar wrote many books on economics in the first part. After the second part of his life, he did not write any book on economics, but everything that he did in the second part also had influence of Dr. Ambedkar as an economist, including the Constitution of India. If you compare Indian Constitution with the Constitution of other democracies, one of the distinctive features of Indian Constitution is that it has more provisions of economics than any other constitution. The reason being, the architect, the principal architect of that constitution, was a scholar who was basically economist by training. So let's talk about these two parts. First, I'm going to talk about his academic contribution to economics, and then about his practical contribution to policy making. Dr. Ambedkar wrote two books on economics, actually three, but his thesis for MA was very small, 40 pages. So that was a booklet, and the same subject was expounded in his PhD dissertation. So let's focus on his two big books on economics. The two big books on economics, first is his PhD thesis, and the second one is his Doctor of Science thesis. His PhD thesis was termed The Evolution of Provincial Finances in British India. The Evolution of Provincial Finances in British India. What does Dr. Ambedkar do? I'm going to make it very, very simple for everybody to understand. And I want to relate that with what is going on now to show how they are relevant even today. So the evolution of provincial finance in British India. What does Dr. Ambedkar try to achieve in that book? In that book, he takes a period of 1833 to 1920. And during that period, he analyzes how the relationship between the British central government and British provincial government. As you know, there are three provinces, Madras, Bombay, and Calcutta. So the relationship between the central government and the provincial government. We now call them states. Those days there were only provinces, and there were three provinces. So the relationship between, in the modern language, he was talking about central-state fiscal relations. Central-state fiscal relations. Those days, since there were three provinces, so he talks about provincial finances. So focus was, he analyzes the fiscal relationship, financial relationship between the central government, the imperial central government, and the governments of the provinces then, for this period, 1833 to 1920, and comes up with a very incisive historical analysis. And then towards the end, he talks about what should be the ideal relationship between central government and the states. And in that, he gives some principles of ideal relationship between central government and the provinces, or states as we call them now. What is the relevance of this book today? It is very relevant. It is not important only in the historical context. There is no British government, there are no provinces, but we have central government, we have states, and the principles that he had initiated there are even valid today as much as they were at that time. Now, how are they valid today? All of you would recall that there is something called Finance Commission, which is established in India every 5 years. Every 5 years there is a Finance Commission that is established, and this provision is there in the Constitution. In fact, the 12th Finance Commission was headed by same Dr. Rangarajan some years ago, much afterwards, after our debate. But 12th Finance Commission was headed by Dr. Rangarajan, 13th Finance Commission was headed by Dr. My friend from Maharashtra, and Vijay Kelkar. And it has submitted the report. It submitted the report last year. So 13 finance commissions have given report. What do these finance commissions do? The job of finance commission is to analyze the resources which are collected by the central government and by the states. And how do you allocate those resources between the tax revenue and non-tax revenue? How is it to be allocated between how much will the central government keep and how much will be given on to the states? Now that is one way to look at the work that is being done every 5 years by the Finance Commission. You will be surprised to know that although in the independent India there are 13th Finance Commission report, the basic source of reference for all the finance commissions that have come so far is Dr. Ambedkar's book that was written for his PhD. It's highly regrettable that we know about finance commission, but we do not know that the finance commission's basis of all the 13 report happens to be the inspiration, basic inspiration, comes from Dr. Ambedkar's book, which was his PhD dissertation. The second book that Dr. Ambedkar wrote was The Problem of Rupee, Its Origin and Solution. Problem of Rupee, Its Origin and Solution. It's an enormously complicated book. And to my mind, if all books of Dr. Ambedkar are wonderful, but if I were to rank the books of Dr. Ambedkar, I would say Buddha Gautama is his finest book. The second, my favorite second is Annihilation of Caste. And the third book, in my opinion, of all the books that he has written, which are my favorite, is The Problem of Rupee. Problem of Rupee is an enormously complicated book, and I had to struggle several months to understand that book. I'm going to make it very simple for you, but I would also like to say this, that I'm yet to meet a professor of economics from any university in our country who will come to me and give me the hand on his chest and tell me that he has understood the problem of rupee. You know, after 10 pages, people give up. It's an enormously difficult book. But I'm going to tell you the gist of that in a very simple terms. What does Dr. Ambedkar do in this book, which was his Doctor of Science thesis? He analyzes, he again takes a historical, starts with a historical perspective. And for the period 1833 to 1921, he analyzes how Indian rupee has evolved over these years as a medium of exchange. How has it evolved for this 100-year-odd period, 1833 to 1921? And then at the end, as he did for his PhD thesis, Dr. Ambedkar talks about some principles. And the issue that he addresses, what is the ideal form of currency for a country like India, for a developing country like India? That time, there was a debate going on between two alternative schools of thought. One was called gold standard, and the other one was called gold exchange standard. What is the difference between gold standard and gold exchange standard? Gold standard is something where gold by itself is used as a currency. Whereas in the gold exchange standard, it is not the metal as the gold which is used as a means of payment, as a means of currency, but paper currency is used, which is backed, which is supported, backed by certain amount of gold that the government has. So that is in simple terms. I'm making it very, very simple. So gold standard is where gold itself is used as a medium of exchange, whereas in the gold exchange standard, it is the paper currency that is used as a medium of exchange, which is supported or backed by certain amount of gold reserves that the government has kept. So the debate was going on for a developing country like India, which is the perfect system? Is it gold standard or gold exchange standard? All the economists at that time favored gold standard. You know why? Vice Chancellor, while making his observations, talked about Keynes. Keynes had spent some time in India in the early part of 20th century. I think 1909 or thereabout. And Keynes wrote a book where he talks about the ideal currency system for a developing country like India. Keynes is of that generation, the ultimate economist, the whole world worshipped him. Keynes took a position that gold standard is no good, is for a country like India. He said that gold standard is a very rigid standard. Under gold standard, the amount of currency that would be available in the country would depend on the amount of gold which is there available in the country. And that will restrain the economic growth and development for want of liquidity. He said gold exchange standard is better. And why is gold exchange standard better? His argument that was that gold exchange standard would give the kind of flexibility that is required, and that flexibility would be essential, would come in handy, would be useful for a developing country like India. Now, when Lord Keynes took that position, all his followers in India and abroad, of course, were bound to follow the line and said that gold exchange standard is the perfect system for India. It was opposed by one person. That person was young economist Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar came back from England in the year 1924. And in 1926, I'm talking about part of history which is not properly documented. Please note. 1926, there was a commission came to India which was called Hilton Young Commission. The job of Hilton Young Commission was to establish central bank for the country, the Reserve Bank of India. Whether or not it should be done and what manner it should be done, that was done on the basis of the report that was provided by the Hilton Young Commission. Dr. Ambedkar, as a young economist, made a presentation, gave a testimony to it before the Hilton Young Commission. And he made an argument there, which is available. In fact, I dug it out from the old archives when I was working with the Reserve Bank of India. And that was the point of debate with the Dr. Rangarajan in that speech. What Dr. Ambedkar argued was that flexibility of gold exchange standard is certainly desirable, but it is a double-edged weapon. If the government is responsible, the flexibility that is available in the gold exchange standard would be certainly useful. But if the government is irresponsible, what will happen? If the government is irresponsible, it is liable to be misused. Then government can recklessly issue lot of currency that will create a situation of too much money chasing too few goods. The result would be inflation, and inflation would hit the poor people the most. And therefore, there should be a limit. Therefore, he argued that gold exchange standard is not necessarily better than gold standard. And he, while talking about establishing the Reserve Bank of India, the central bank for the country, he said that there must be, the language was different, remember, later on the language of economic change, basic argument remained. He said that government, there must be some provision for controlling the amount of credit that the Reserve Bank will give to the government of India. Because if there is no control on that, there is going to be an unmitigated disaster in terms of too much liquidity being created. That would create a situation of too much money chasing too few goods, and therefore that would be leading to very high inflation, which will hurt the poor the most. This was the advice which was not acceded to in 1926. 1935, 8 to 9 years after that, the Reserve Bank of India came into being. 1st April 1935, RBI was established, and it has done very well, of course. But you know what has happened over a period of time? I want to relate that contribution of that book to situation in the 90s and situation today. What happened was, in RBI, after RBI did very well for many years, but in the decade of 80s, what happened was, you know, there was, by law, the central government maintains an account with the Reserve Bank of India. Individuals can't open account in Reserve Bank of India, but central government has an account. There is a law, provision in the law, that the central government must keep 50 crore rupees as a minimum balance in that account. 50 crore rupees has to be maintained. Now this was very simple and easy to understand. What happened, and this I discovered when I was the secretary of the board of directors to the board of directors of the Reserve Bank of India in 1989. What happened was that became a kind of conflict point between the government of India, Ministry of Finance, and the Reserve Bank of India. You know, because every time they had to make sure that the balance doesn't go below 50, that became very inconvenient. So some smart guy came out. The finance secretary of government of India at that time came out with a suggestion, a solution, that what we must do is that suppose that the balance is exactly 50 crore and Prime Minister wants to announce a new package of 10 crore, that those days 10 crore was a lot of money, as you know. So suppose that government wants to announce a package of 10 crore, what will they do? The balance is only 50 crore, exactly the minimum. The idea that was thought about was that the Reserve Bank should issue to itself an ad hoc treasury bill and give a credit to the account of the government of India. So they will issue the ad hoc treasury bills of 10 crore, so the balance becomes 60 crore. So even if a check of 10 crore is given, the net balance remains 50 crore. It looked like a very nice administrative solution. This is how it happens in our country. What started as a trickle became a flood later on. Can you imagine, during the period from 1955 to 1995, to protect the balance of minimum balance of 50 crore rupees, do you know how much was the total amount of ad hoc treasury bills that were issued? 108,000 crore. So, you know, in North India, they say, Char Ali ki purki aur baradhe ka masala. Here it was 1 paisa ka purki aur 100 paisa rupiye ka masala. This is what happened. To protect the balance of 50 crore, there was so much of ad hoc treasury bills issued, and that was the reason for the high inflation in the decade of 90s. And that is what we were talking about. I was talking about to Dr. Rangarajan in that meeting that I mentioned. The point is that the argument that Dr. Ambedkar had made in his problem of rupee, and the argument that he had made while giving the testimony before the Hilton Young Commission, clearly shows his foresight into the monetary affairs, monetary economics, and we did not listen to him at that time, and the cost that we nation had to pay was in terms of high inflation. I'm very happy to tell you that 1993, 1994, 1995, there was an agreement reached between the Reserve Bank of India and the Ministry of Finance, which ultimately finally placed limit on the amount of credit that the central bank will extend to the central government. So finally, 70 years down the line, we finally got the message, but at a very high cost. And we still do not know that father of this kind of original contribution was Dr. Ambedkar. This is his academic contribution. Let me turn to his other contribution. In the, you know, much as he wanted, Dr. Ambedkar wanted to write many more books on economics. He did not. He was drawn into the political movement. He did write many books, but not per se on economics. But everything that he did had a imprint of Dr. Ambedkar as an economist. Let's start with agriculture. On agriculture, he wrote a paper on the small holdings, which is a classic one. Very, very old paper on small holdings and the problem that it has created. In his movement, you know, there is a system called Khoti system. There was a Khoti system in Maharashtra, which was in the coastal area, Khoti system, which was a form of Jamindari, which was called Khoti system. And the Khots were Jamindars who were exploiting the poor people. And Dr. Ambedkar came up against the Khoti system. And he organized those farmers against the Khoti system, and finally it was abolished. At that time, can you imagine, Dr. Ambedkar wrote presented in 1926. He also became a nominated member of the provincial assembly. In that nominated member, he presented a bill about prohibition of money lenders. And even today, that looks a fresh kind of thing. Now, when, you know, until recently, before IT revolution, whenever we went to bank, we would always get a passbook, right? He said that the passbook should be there not only for deposit holders, but even for all loan account holders, there must be a passbook, where it would be clearly indicated how much was the loan taken, how much was the interest, and how much has been paid, how much of the interest has been paid, and how much of the principal has been paid. So every creditor must give every debtor a passbook which will be regulated. And all the money lenders must be regulated by the state government very rigorously. And if there is any malpractice that is found, the money lender must be, you know, his license must be cancelled. Those were the very strong provisions. You know, many years later, recently, 2 years ago, when there were many farmer suicide in Maharashtra, and the government of Maharashtra had appointed a committee under my chairmanship to look into farmer suicide, you know, I saw the kind of provisions that, the role that money lenders have played, you know, very, very vitiating, very socially, very highly undesirable role that was played by money lenders. And absolutely, literally no control over money lenders. And I was reminded of this 1928 bill that Dr. Ambedkar had submitted. That again goes to show his foresight. This is about the agriculture, about the industry. Do you know that when Ambedkar was a little boy, he wanted to run away to Mumbai and become a worker in the mill? The reason was, he was in Satara and he was a little boy. And his father remarried, and he was very unhappy that his father had remarried. So he wanted to run away from his father, from Satara, to go to Mumbai to become a mill worker. So three times, you know, in the night he used to sleep with his aunt. So three times he tried to steal some money from the purse of the aunt, which was there, you know, the old style purse that was there with the aunt. Fortunately for you and for me, the aunt never had enough money which would finance Bar Bivar going to Mumbai to become the worker. So he could never get money, he could never run away. And the same Bar Bivar became the first labor minister of our country. I think this is a lot of historical, poetic justice is involved here. In 1942, there was the first government that came into being. The Viceroy's Executive Council is what it was called, and the ministers were called members. In that, Dr. Ambedkar was a labor member, and a labor minister for a few years that he was there. He made huge changes that are, you know, the changes are recognized, but we don't attribute them to Dr. Ambedkar. Let me give you an example. Everybody knows about employment exchanges. Who was the first person who came up with the idea of employment exchange? All of us are aware of employment exchange. We are all connected with it. It was Dr. Ambedkar. Have you seen the construction workers? Construction workers, it looks very incongruous. All construction workers will wear those gumboots. Those who are working in the tar, they all wear gumboots. Even that was the one, was something that was introduced by Dr. Ambedkar. We have tripartite method of negotiation on the industrial disputes between the government, between the employers and employees, employee organizations, trade unions. That tripartite mechanism of settling the industrial dispute in this country was introduced by Dr. Ambedkar as the minister. He was also having the charge of power and water. Those were not big ministries at that time, but many dams which came out during that period. You know, Dr. Ambedkar, as a great social scientist, had actually worked out the engineering details of Hirakunda Dam and many other dams, and the contribution has now come out of, as a minister, how he was also involved in the technical details of many of those massive projects. Although he did not have an engineering background, genius that he was, he got into the economics of dams, and was one champion of those projects at that time as a minister. This is about the industry. Then comes the social sector. You know, in the social sector, please understand that that all the time, you know, his contribution, even in the social sector, bears the imprint of Dr. Ambedkar as an economist. Let me give you an example. There was a time when there was a tendency in some quarters to bring back the old traditions in the new name, in the new disguise, and giving them scientific looking outlook. There was a time when some people had argued that it is very important to take plunge into Ganga. You know why? Because the water of Ganga has some bacteria, you know, has capacity, some there, it has some bacteria which will kill all the bad bacteria in our body. All irate nonsense. But, you know, the worst was, Dr. Ambedkar did not give this example, but I have read it elsewhere, that, you know, there were some people who actually defended keeping the pigtail shady. You know what was the reason given? The reason given was that if you have a pigtail, it creates an electromagnetic field around your head. All nonsense, irate nonsense. But the point is, that was the time when attempt was made by a lot of people to bring back the old tradition, giving them a scientific look. That was the time when Dr. Ambedkar came out with a very hard-hitting critic of the caste system in our country. The first scholar who talked about the economics of caste system was Dr. Ambedkar. And he argued that this caste system has done irreparable damage to India's economic growth and development. And there was a, you know, in his annihilation of caste, he made that argument. 1936 was the year, and immediately after his that book came out, there was a lot of opposition. You know, a lot of opposition, and strangely or ironically, the opposition came from Mahatma Gandhi. And you should all see the debate between Mahatma Gandhi and Dr. Ambedkar on the issue of Chaturvarna. You know, one of the points of that debate was, a lot of people had defended the Varnashram Samstha, you know, the division, fourfold classification between Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, saying that this is something that is required for social stability. That system of Chaturvarnya, it was argued by some defenders that is required for social stability. So, you know, there is the fourfold division, there is the Brahmin, there is the Vaishya, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. This is something, and some people took it to economics and said, this is nothing but division of labor. In economics, one of the most important basic principles is division of labor. So there were people who argued that this kind of stratification of society is indeed, it is indeed division of labor. And division of labor is a time-honored principle of economics, and therefore there is nothing wrong in the caste system or the Varnashram system. In his hard-hitting critic, Dr. Ambedkar said, and this is very important, this shows his razor-sharp intellect. He said that what we have, the division that we have, in terms of Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, this is not division of labor. Superimposed on this division of labor is the division of laborers. A son of a Brahmin, even if he is a hopeless vagabond, nobody took away his right to preach. On the other hand, son of a Dalit, a son of an untouchable, even if he was a genius, he was never given the opportunity to exhibit his mettle. He had to do the menial jobs assigned to the caste into which or she is born. This is not division of labor. What is imposed, what is happening here, is that superimposed on the caste system was division of, not, what was superimposed on the division of labor was division of laborers. Division of labor is nothing wrong in division of labor, but the moment you make the division of labor based on the accident of birth, the caste into which you are born, you are stuck then it does not remain the division of labor, it becomes division of laborers. There is nothing wrong in division of labor, but everything is wrong in division of laborers based on the caste. And therefore, by implication, he said that this has done irreparable damage to India's economic growth and development, and that, you know, it's a caste system that has done irreparable damage to economic growth and development of this country. Now, these are various dimensions of Dr. Ambedkar's contribution. What is the common thing which is connecting this diverse contribution that Dr. Ambedkar made to economics? There are many, but there is one, if I want to see one common theme that connects everything that Dr. Ambedkar did in economics, including writing those scholarly books and including the movement, social movement that he ran. I think the principle involved, sutra, the principle involved would be Bahujana Hitaya, Bahujana Sukhaya. Bahujana Hitaya, Bahujana Sukhaya is which is at the center of all that Dr. Ambedkar was saying in terms of his contributions as well as in terms of the movement that he organized. When he wrote The Evolution of Provincial Finances in British India, he was talking about distribution of the funds collected, the tax and non-tax revenue, in a manner that will reach the poorest of the poor. So a poor person was at the helm. When he wrote about the technical book about the problem of rupees, original solution, when he discussed the issue of currency crisis, he was talking about having a mechanism, a currency system that will protect the ordinary persons, ordinary human beings, ordinary people from the monsters of inflation, because inflation is an iniquitous form of taxation which hurts the poor the most, and this is what was the focus. When he did his Koti Andolan, you know, movement for against Koti, he was talking about poor. When he did when he was the labor member or labor minister, all that he did was again with focus on labor for the common man. And of course, the social contribution that he has made again has common man, Antyodaya, as the focus of all that he was trying to do. And therefore, one sutra or one principle that encompasses the entire vast, disparate contribution that Dr. Ambedkar made, it is Bahujana Hitaya, Bahujana Sukhaya. If you see the last speech made by this Honorable Minister Chidambaram, as the Finance Minister, in the last para of that speech, I think 2 years ago, there is what he talks about, the largest good, greatest good for the largest number of people. What does that mean? It only means Bahujana Hitaya, Bahujana Sukhaya, which was the essence of Dr. Ambedkar's economic thoughts and philosophy. I'm aware that I have only given you a trailer of the multifaceted contribution that Dr. Ambedkar has made, but if it kindles a desire in you to look into greater details of the great contributions that Dr. Ambedkar has made as an economist, I think my coming here, I would feel, was really worthwhile. I want to thank the organizers for having given me this opportunity to come here and talk to all of you on a subject of a great contemporary relevance. And I also want to thank the ONGC authorities for making it possible for me to come here and give this endowment lecture for you. And of course, I want to thank all of you for a very patient hearing. I wish all of you all the very best. Thank you.